On this feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, the scriptures offer us the opportunity to reflect on the three major figures in our Carmelite tradition: Jesus, Elijah, and Mary. And each of them provides, by their words, but also by their actions, their deeds, they provide insight and understanding into the central part of our Carmelite charism, our gift to the church, if you will. And that is the contemplative dimension of life. And I'd like to suggest that what they teach us is really that contemplative life is dangerous. Stuff happens when we take it seriously, when we try to be open to that dimension of life. It's dangerous because it leads us to both purification and solidarity, to the cross and to communion. Today we're celebrating the Feast of Mary, so let's focus on what she teaches us about contemplative living. Well, first of all, you know, the Gospels don't provide a lot of information about Mary. In fact, while she's central to the action of God in Jesus Christ, we see Mary only really five times in the Gospels. And you know what they are. They're the Annunciation, the birth of Jesus and the flight into Egypt, the loss of Jesus in Jerusalem that we just heard, the wedding feast at Cana, and her presence at the foot of the cross. But in each of these, while there are only five of them, if you will, in each of these five cameos, she maps out for us the experience and the result of contemplative living. Each of these experiences were deeply human experiences, deeply human experiences of God's action in her life. But it's important, I think, to emphasize how human these experiences were. Because our piety over the years, over the centuries really, our piety has gotten us away from the fact that Mary was a human being. And sometimes an emphasis more on a sense of divinity than her humanity. And we put her on a pedestal that sometimes removes her from the human experience. But think about it. Think about these five experiences. She knew what it was like to conceive and give birth to a child. How human is that? She knew what it was to be a refugee, fleeing her homeland to protect her child and family. How human and current is that reality? She knew what it was to be separated from her child, to not know where he was, to be frightened at the possible horrible, horrific outcomes because of that separation. How human and current is that? She knew what it was to open her young son's eyes, her young adult son's eyes, to the very simple, almost mundane needs of people at a wedding feast. And finally, she knew what it was to watch her child die as a common privilege. Our first exposure to Mary, of course, is the Annunciation. But the pattern of her contemplative response to life is there for us. She has a deep experience of the movement of God in her life. And she was obviously steeped in the scriptures because she came to believe in faith that God was somehow or other acting in her life, even if in a most extraordinary kind of way. It was a mystery for her, but her knowledge of God helped her to say fiat, to say yes, in faith, to participate in God's embrace of our humanity. And we see that same pattern of Mary always showing up. She always shows up, doesn't she? She's always showing up in the most human of life's experiences. And in showing up, she's always responding. She's always acting. She's always saying her yes to God's invitation to be his contemplative presence in our world. Pope Francis, a week ago, Friday, said Mass for immigrants in Rome. And he did it on the fifth anniversary of his visit to Lampedusa, the island off the Italian coast, which has been where they've been receiving refugees for a long time. And if you recall, that was the first journey, pastoral visit he did after his election 4 months prior to that. And in this, in his homily at this Mass a week ago Friday, he reminded us and Western society of our responsibility to care for others. In his homily, he talked of this, and I quote, "The migrants and refugees who continue to knock at the door of nations that enjoy our great prosperity." And he challenged us to say with these words, he says, "The Lord needs our eyes to see the needs of our brothers and sisters. He needs our hands to offer them help. He needs our voice to protest the injustices committed thanks to the silence, often complicit, of so many." And he goes on to say, "I should really speak of many silences, the silence of common sense, the silence that thinks it's always been done that way, the silence of us as opposed to you. Above all, the Lord needs our hearts to show his merciful love towards the least, the outcast, the abandoned, the marginalized." If you know Teresa of Avila, that sounds familiar, doesn't it? I'm sure he borrowed it. So he's challenging us to not be silent. And Mary was never silent. When her son was lost, she acted in faith to search for him, to embrace him when she saw him, and to scold him a little bit. In that experience, she knew the cross of fear and loss, as well as the communion of his being found. The mothers and fathers along our southern border can find in Mary the support and solace of a woman who knows what it is to be separated from her child, and who used her eyes, her hands, her voice to express God's merciful love and her own. So on this feast of Mary, Our Lady of Mount Carmel, she challenges us, as does Pope Francis, to be God's eyes, God's hands, God's voice, to express God's merciful love towards the least, the outcast, the abandoned, the marginalized. It's the best way, I think, for us to honor Mary, our mother and sister in Carmel, on this her feast day. May we continue to learn from her how to be contemplative disciples of her son, Jesus, to embrace the purification and the solidarity, cross and the communion in our lives.